what I found out over the years is that you can speak against the far right and they'll generally ignore you because there aren't so many people who really like the far right. But when you start naming them and when you start giving details about them, their ears perk up. And when you get identified by the far right, you know, death threats are sure to follow. I ended up being surrounded by a group of Proud Boys who were trying to goad me into getting in a fight with them, which was very tense.
What's your real name?
I've been the object of a morphing conspiracy theory. They had decided that I was the Jewish ideological leader of Antifa. Then pictures have been coming out of this guy named QAnon Shaman. And I had gotten a screenshot that somebody sent me of a fellow named Lynn Wood who was claiming that the QAnon Shaman was actually me. So my name's Spencer Sunshine. I've been the object of a morphing conspiracy theory for about a decade, alleging that I am variously the international leader of Antifa, and more recently that I'm the QAnon Shaman. So I'm a monitor of the United States far right. We do a lot of eavesdropping on far right media. So you read people's websites, get involved in their social media, see what they're all talking about. Usually you do this by creating a fake persona. And then this way you essentially become a member of their movement and you listen to their chatter and what their discussions are and what they're planning. I'd given a talk to a group called Rose City Antifa about anti-Semitism and left-wing movements. There had been a local progressive organizer who had, through contact with far-right groups, gotten involved in Holocaust denial. One was an anti-abortion activist who had done a bombing. So this started upsetting the anti-fascists who were part of the progressive scene, and they were in a campaign to try to run this fellow and some other anti-Semites out. On their invitation, I gave a talk in 2010 about this matter. And this is what attracted the attention of neo-Nazis. One fellow in particular, who was very anti-Semitic, because I gave a talk about anti-Semitism and part of my family's Jewish, decided that I was the Jewish ideological leader of Antifa. And that's the start of the conspiracy theory. It was pulling directly off of classic anti-Semitic tropes. They were very consistent in identifying me as being Jewish.
Jews will not replace us! Jews will not replace us!
So at Charlottesville on August 12, 2017, it was the biggest fascist-led rally in the United States, probably since the 1970s. Up to 1,000 people came to the rally. There was a counter-protest that was about the same size. There was open fighting between the fascists and the anti-fascists. And at one point, as the march went up a narrow street, a car driven by one of the fascist activists at high speed drove directly into the crowd. He ended up killing one person and injuring about 30 others. What happened after Charlottesville, you know, with this new wave of neo-Nazis and other white nationalists, who at the time had a lot of inertia behind them and were becoming more and more violent, started to fixate on me. That's when the death threats started to pile in. I got messages like, I have a bullet for you. And you'd make a complaint to Facebook and they'd be like, well, we don't see a problem, you know, with this message coming out of the blue to you. That's really the one time that I got quite nervous. I had seen people on these discussion boards, one of them be like, oh, I know that guy, he lives in my neighborhood. So, you know, I had good reason to think that people had an idea of where I lived, and clearly by the comments, they would have liked to inflict harm on me. So about a month after Charlottesville, I had taken an assignment to cover the mother of all rallies. It was a sort of far-right rally in Washington, D.C. A person there, who I later found out was a far-right conspiracy theorist, he saw me in the crowd. He started chanting that I was Antifa and yelling and following me around and yelling this.
I put my name in the speech, and then 2 weeks later, I get attacked by a bunch of people trained in an Antifa base. Trained these two morons that attacked me.
I ended up being surrounded by a group of Proud Boys who were trying to goad me into getting in a fight with them, which was very tense. And then afterwards, this conspiracy theorist put a video out of it claiming that I was there undercover to go dox far-right activists. And this was kind of funny. If I was the international leader of Antifa, why would I go do the grunt work myself? But, you know, the conspiracy theories are just a story that they're trying to work around into a new format. So in this case, I had originally been identified as a specifically Jewish, you know, leader of Antifa that was coming to do damage to far-right nationalist movements. And as the conspiracy theory evolved over the years, like the Jewish part went away, but I was still the Antifa leader who was still trying to, you know, manipulate or in a devious way hurt far-right movements. Now, before the Capitol takeover, there was this claim, which had gone around several times, that Antifa was going to go disguised as Trump supporters.
According to a tweet, a week after the elections, Antifa from Antifa's hometown of Portland, Oregon, will be mixing in with the crowd of Trump supporters who will assemble in Washington, D.C. around the national capitol on January 6th. The Antifa folks, however, will be dressed just like the Trump supporters to try to blend in.
And in this way, the Trumpists can claim that anything violent or illegal that happens was actually Antifa in disguise, right? So I had been following the demonstration on Twitter. I was following several accounts of people who were there on the ground. And as it sort of wound down, and pictures have been coming out of this guy named QAnon Shaman, who was this fellow in horn helmet and furs and face paint carrying a spear. He's a fairly well-known figure to people, always comes in costume.
Freedom!
Freedom!
I had gotten a screenshot that somebody sent me of a fellow named Lynn Wood who was claiming that the QAnon Shaman was actually me. And this was the first time that I became aware that something might be wrong. So the first thing I saw is that Linwood had almost a million Twitter followers. And I was like, oh shit, this is not just like some crackpot with like 80 followers. And the second thing is I learned who Linwood was fairly quickly. He had been one of the lawyers who was doing the Kraken lawsuits. These were the state level lawsuits to try to claim that the Democrats had rigged the election in each state. And apparently he had a, you know, reputation of making outlandish claims and slanders against various people. So at that point, I started to get very concerned because I knew that this was going to go downhill very quickly. The post ended up getting like tens of thousands of shares. I started getting death threats, as I knew I would, and this stuff went on for a few days. The QAnon Shaman, whose name is Jake Angeli, went on the thread and got really angry at Linwood because he, you know, was a actual believer in the Q conspiracy theory, and he was being thrown under the bus by Wood for unknown reasons. I think maybe Wood thought he was a bad face of the Capitol takeover. The screenshot of both Wood's tweet and his response, it ended up on a Know Your Meme website. Previously, you know, all these rumors about me being the international leader of Antifa or whatever were limited to very small circles. There had already been this far-right conspiratorial talking point that really all the violence at the Capitol was Antifa. And then I became the face of it. But this conspiracy theory itself was repeated even that night when the joint session reconvened of both the Senate and the House. A Republican House member repeated this conspiracy theory on the floor, claiming that it was Antifa that had, you know, caused the violence at the takeover.
Some of the people who breached the Capitol today were not Trump supporters. They were masquerading as Trump supporters, and in fact, were members of the violent terrorist group Antifa.
This had been a sort of new level of popularity for these conspiracy theories. In the future, I am a little nervous that, especially because of the level that the conspiracy theory reached, that it's going to be picked up about me again, and if it's been increasing in size almost every time. So yeah, I'd really rather not be denounced by a senator this time. You know, the more time that the conspiracy theorists have spent targeting me, it's almost good because all the things that I'm being accused of, I'm not doing, and it takes the attention off of other people. So in a sense, I've actually let this roll on because as long as they focus on me, they're not going to be focusing on the people who are really taking the most active measures against the far right.